Good evening, everybody. I'm George Andreopoulos. I'm the director of the Center for International Human Rights. And on behalf of our center, I would like to welcome you all to this evening's event, Connecting Girls, Inspiring Futures, Challenges and Prospects for Global Empowerment. And it's an event we are organizing in order to celebrate International Women's Day. The theme that has been chosen this year, Connecting Girls, Inspiring Future, raises several critical issues, three of which I will briefly highlight in my welcoming remarks. The first one is the right to participate, which goes beyond the ability to take part in the conduct of public affairs, and it relates to the ability to influence structures and situations that affect one's life. The meaningful exercise of this ability is clearly dependent on the satisfaction of certain basic needs relating to health, education, and physical security, among others. The second is the relation of the right to participate to empowerment, and in particular, to economic empowerment, which also remains a formidable challenge as the right to participate for many, many women of all ages around the globe. Economic empowerment, according to UN Women, is a very serious problem. More than 800 million women lack the education, training, and opportunities to participate fully in economic life. And as is well known, economic empowerment makes other rights possible for women. And the third issue, which I think is relevant, and as I've said before, this list is by no means exhaustive, of course, is the issue of connectivity. And this, as far as I'm concerned, refers not only to the ability to communicate and interact within borders, but also across borders. There is an ongoing global conversation on issues of participation and empowerment, in which global norms and standards have to be made relevant in local contexts. And such local understandings not only have the potential of empowering women and girls at the local level, but they also bounce back and they are the global level, and they can enrich our understandings of these concepts at the local level, and they can inform the global conversation. So it is clearly important when we think in terms of connectivity to think not only in terms of what the global can offer to the local, but what the local also can offer to the global. Some of these issues will be addressed in a report that our center is preparing based on this theme, Connecting Girls, Inspiring Futures, the Challenges and Prospects for Global Empowerment, which will be completed shortly, and we'll be posting it on the center's website. In addition to discussing these issues at a more general level, we'll be highlighting some of the challenges and opportunities facing global empowerment for women and girls through the examination of three case studies: Palestine, Liberia, and Kosovo. So please stay tuned for this report. And these are some of the issues also that our distinguished group of panelists who have accepted our invitation to participate in this evening's event will be addressing. Before I give the floor to Aferdita, who will be offering her own thoughts on some of these issues and introducing our panelists, I would like to thank all those who made this event possible. First of all, of course, our distinguished panelists, Rosemary, Barbara, Conor, and I'm sorry if I kill it, Qaterannada, is that okay?
That's perfect.
All right, I'm trying. Okay, thank you very much for being with us this evening, and we very much look forward to your remarks. Of course, the staff at our center, and it's a growing family, our center, Aferdita, Sarah, Xenia, Trisha, Lydia, Shelby, and Lina. I hope I didn't leave anybody out. Huh? And Saida, yes. I also want to thank somebody who cannot be with us today, Failin Prue, for designing the poster that we have prepared for this event. And we would like to very much acknowledge her contribution and offer our thanks. And also, Last but not least, I would like to thank the co-sponsor of this event, the BA program in International Criminal Justice and the MA program in International Crime and Justice, whose director is with us this evening, Rosemary, and will be addressing our panel. One last thing before I give the floor to Aferdita. On the back there, we have some brochures of the center, and I would encourage you to pick up on brochure to see some of the work that we're doing in other issue areas. And I would also ask you to, those of you who are not on our listserv, to sign up on the sheet that we have back there so that you'll be notified of our upcoming events and also notify once our report is ready and uploaded so that you can read it. Without further ado, I would like to thank you once again for being here with us this evening. And I'll now give the floor to Aferdita, who will moderate the panel and lead the discussion. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us here in celebration of International Women's Day in an academic setting such as John Jay College. Before we move on to our speakers, I want to give you a small sample from my upcoming report, that we're working on here at the center, to set the stage for tonight's panel. Since I'm originally from Kosovo and spent time working for the United Nations mission in Kosovo following the war in 1999, I researched the youth empowerment programs that specifically targeted younger females in the region. Given Kosovo's recent declaration of independence in 2008, there has been considerable progress. However, many challenges still lay ahead as it is being recognized by, as it's attempting to be recognized by countries and continues on peace-building initiatives to ensure that it does not relapse into the conflict that enabled its independence. The role of women and girls' participation in the peace-building process is an essential component to development and the future stability of the region. Kosovo has one of the youngest populations in all of Europe, with its population, with 50% of its population under the age of 25 and about 21% of its population between the ages of 15 and 25. Despite the abundance of governmental policies and nonprofit organizations working on youth and women's empowerment issues, the number of adolescents that engage and participate in decisions affecting their daily lives is significantly very low. The challenges related to political, economic, and social development during the ongoing transitional period are the first and foremost obstacles of the young people, who are the country's future leaders and workers, parents, business owners, and thus far. Lack of participation, however, is not unique to youth itself. It's relatively low across the generation. Entire population there. Kosovo's population is mainly rural, though the last decade has dramatically seen migration towards the urban areas. It's important to note that 60% of the population in Kosovo is coming from a rural background, while 40% of the population is considered to be urban. So, an urban setting would be the capital of Pristina. As a result of these demographics, there are two conflicting views between the rural traditional and the progressive urban. According to the 2011 UNDP Public Pulse Report, number 2, Kosovo's participation index is at a 0.13 rate, a decrease from 0.24 in November 2010. Indicating a very low public participation in its political and civic life. Males participate at a rate of 0.18 and females at 0.07, which also means a gender imbalance. despite the general progress made in women's empowerment, such as the president of the country being the first female president, young women still face three main challenges to participation related to cultural norms of the societal roles, low levels of education, and lack of economic security. The patriarchal culture is another critical factor underlining the low level of female participation in the society that does not see females as a political political decision makers. This general perception leads to wider discrimination and a vicious cycle of low levels of education and economic insecurity. Girls have a higher dropout rate than boys after the first 9 years of education and schooling. This rate increases, especially in rural areas and among minorities. Consequently, women are three times more likely to be illiterate than men and are more likely to be unemployed. The unemployment level for women in Kosovo is 55% compared to a 39% in males. Moreover, youth unemployment is at a 72% rate in Kosovo, which is five times higher than the average within the European Union, a particular cause for concern with youth empowerment initiatives. Kosovo has received substantial resources to aid its recovery, including resources targeting youth, but little has been focused towards girls and young women. In achieving desirable outcomes for female participation, there must be continued cooperation and coordination among the government as well as the civil society. Placing the youth's concerns at the center of addressing the multitude of the problems will likely determine the country's path to stability and the prevention of further human rights abuses. Kosovo's young people and the untapped prospect of women are potentially powerful allies in the development of the new country. Young people have more elastic attitudes towards traditional gender and social roles. They are capable of crossing ethnic, cultural, and gender boundaries and have the greatest stake in its future. The creation of a nonviolent, peaceful Kosovo, which values the rule of law and the equality of all males and females, is substantially in the hands of the youth. There are numerous initiatives on the ground at this time that are working to tackle the issues relating to women and girls, and as George mentioned earlier, we'll be producing a report that will discuss these projects as well as challenges. My personal beliefs in the global empowerment of young females are linked to common moral and ethical views that are interrelated to self-confidence, happiness, and success. These terms connect all girls in post-conflict as well as developed countries with common challenges that they encounter. Looking under the surface of deeply embedded ideas by analyzing the way that we treat one another, methods of communication, as well as listening skills, are pretty much the heart of the issue. One philosophical argument relevant that women may relate, one philosophical argument that women may relate to is that women relate their quality of life based on the relationships that they have with individuals in their lives. In this regard, the younger generation can learn and be empowered by the experiences of the wiser generation. The older generation of women have an ethical responsibility to equip and support the younger generation. In turn, the youth must respect and embrace the guidance of their elders, even in the face of elevated obstacles that lay ahead as time proceeds. Based on this assumption, women should support, encourage, and influence other girls by means of offering advice, help, and in most cases, simply by listening. By working together, young females are connecting their voice, strengthening bonds that will help overcome obstacles put in their path, and inspiring futures. I'd like to end with remarks that when my friend once told me, do not ever underestimate the power of sisterhood. Today, we have with us a group of individuals from different backgrounds to discuss some of the challenges and prospects for connecting girls and inspiring futures in the quest for global empowerment. I'll take this time to introduce our first speaker, Professor Rosemary Barberet, who's an associate professor of sociology at John Jay College. Let us all welcome Professor Barberet.
Thank you. Is this on? Is it working? Okay. Thank you. I understand my role this evening is to somewhat introduce the topic of women's issues in the international arena, and this is something I'm very happy to do. And under the authority or the auspices of the Department of Public Information, we have just been allowed to take on two new youth representatives, which is, I think, a wonderful opportunity to involve young people as observers at the UN. And although there was fairly little interest for this at John Jay, we do have now a youth representative who is an undergraduate criminal justice major. And I think I'll comment some of her experiences throughout my introduction today, if only because I find that there is a lot of eagerness within the UN to involve young people, but there's not quite a place for them. And there's often not really a way for them to make their voice heard separately maybe from the older generations. And this I hear very much from our youth representative, because I tell her constantly that she must be the youth voice, that whatever she observes, whatever room she's in, she needs to always think young and think not only young but young woman. But oftentimes I find that even among the NGO community, there's very much an age skew, certainly at the UN. There are very few young people that are in positions of authority. It's simply the way the organization works, a fairly conservative organization in terms of its human resources. And even the NGO community is also aging and eager, but I think ignorant of how to attract young people. And often I think considers young people to be sort of mini-me's, people that you think one day will be like you, and so you're going to train them to think like you, but not really allow them to change the conversation. And one of the main roles of non-governmental organizations at the United Nations is actually to do that, not only to echo what the UN would like you to echo, but to change the conversation and change the whole idea that's being discussed, involve new ideas and maybe even opposing ideas. In the international arena, there's a progression of steps that have taken place, I would say, over the last 50 years that are of relevance to this session. Some of these are, I suppose, more what I would teach in the classroom than what I would highlight to the audience. But the reason that we take gender so seriously in the ICJ major is that, truthfully, anyone who aspires to do intergovernmental work, especially at the United Nations, must know their gender vocabulary. This is a very important skill at the UN. So knowing what gender means as opposed to women, knowing what gender mainstreaming, gender budgeting, these sorts of terms are not sort of frills that we might relegate to women's studies in academia. These are very important workplace skills. Gender advisor and gender specialist positions are now quite common throughout the UN system. They're quite common in consultancy work, as well as in work in non-governmental organizations. It simply is becoming an increasingly important workplace skill to know how to talk and do gender and women. How has this evolved? It's evolved through a series of international treaties and meetings, Security Council resolutions, the very important development of a transnational non-governmental women's rights community, the advent of the Millennium Development Goals, the work of the international tribunals, including the Rome Statute of the ICC. All of these things have sort of put women's issues in the forefront of international policymaking. The first step really being the CEDAW, the Convention of Elimination of Discrimination Against Women from 1979, which the United States has still not signed, but the vast majority of countries in the world have signed, and which feminists in the United States thought Obama would sign in 2010, for which there was a very active campaign mounted, but this has not occurred. A later protocol to CEDAW established a monitoring committee, the CEDAW committee, which meets in New York in July and is open to observation, which is the venue at which countries must report what they have done to be in compliance with CEDAW and are named and shamed if they are not in compliance, a very important body. The Commission on the Status of Women meets in New York every February and March, and is another venue for important policymaking, not necessarily binding, but policymaking in terms of guidelines, norms, decision statements, conclusions that have to do with gender equality and women's rights in the global arena. And the Commission of Status of Women was tasked with the follow-up platform of action from the Beijing, the very important Beijing Fourth World Conference on Women, which established a series of priorities for women's rights that continue to the present day, and which was the first place where women's rights were fully integrated into human rights. So where you hear women's rights are human rights and human rights are women's rights is because of the Beijing Fourth World Conference. And why is this such an important link? Before then, women's rights were seen as special rights, those that were either too trivial to bother to deal with, relegated to small feminist circles, or when considered in their entirety, too overwhelming to take on. But it was through this conference that the transnational women's movement became fully organized, that women from developing countries got on board, especially women in such a country as China, who had never had any contact with feminists from outside China. And a series of priorities were established that now guide the Commission on the Status of Women in its work annually. Accompanying this, we can see the very important work of the ad hoc tribunals, Rwanda and Yugoslavia, in particular in defining sexual violence as a very important issue, sexual violence having been considered before as collateral damage in armed conflict, and it was through the decisions of these tribunals, which were later reflected in the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, that took rape in particular, but many forms of a wide definition of sexual violence and armed conflict to be a fundamentally serious crime of armed conflict. we see this mirrored at a similar point in time in UN Security Council Resolution 1325. Which mandated that sexual violence and armed conflict, but most importantly, the role of women as peace builders, as women that need to be sitting at the peace table and negotiating peace accords, also needs to be fully incorporated into the peace process. This was a landmark resolution, and just 2 weeks ago, we had a panel with Ambassador Chowdhury, who ushered it in as the representative of Bangladesh at that time. It was a fundamental moment, I think, for pacifist feminists, as well as anyone interested in lasting peace accords, because it established that women needed to be at the peace table, and it made a very clear link between gender equality and security, a link that has continued to the present day when we now discuss terrorism and gender equality, a very important conceptual link that was made through UN Security Council 1325. Women's interests are also representative in the Millennium Development Goals, particularly these are development goals, Goal 3, gender equality and women's empowerment, and Goal 5, maternal health, ending particularly deaths related to childbirth. And the most important recent development in terms of women's rights in the international arena is the establishment of UN Women. This was a landmark institution that combines a number of previous institutions that worked for women's rights within the UN system, UNIFEM, INSTRAW, Division of Advancement of Women, the Office of the Special Advisor on Gender Issues to the Secretary General. These were all consolidated into one part of the UN system called UN Women, long advocated and fiercely advocated by the transnational feminist community. Simply because work on gender equality within the UN system to that date had been piecemeal, fundraising had been extremely difficult because there were a number of competing agencies, and there was not one unified voice to push for women's rights. And so now this agency headed by former Chilean President Michelle Bachelet is making strong strides in terms of being the one unified voice for women's issues within the United Nations. Why would this be of interest in a school of criminal justice? This is something I often ask myself. It's obviously very much of interest to people who study human rights, but why would a criminal justice scholar or criminologist be particularly interested in the work in intergovernmental organizations? And here I'll include the World Bank, whose Gender Equality and Development Report has just been released. And I think it is because certainly within this arena, we have a very strong interest in all forms of violence against women, a very broad-based concern with violence against women, and a very internationally-based concern with violence against women. When we speak about violence against women in the United States, we're usually speaking from a criminal justice perspective, and so we're concerned about courts and offenders and victim services and risk factors, reducing domestic violence, and as we read in the New York Times this morning, the renewal of the VAWA, the Violence Against Women Act, is in trouble. In many ways, because the Obama administration has chosen to expand it nicely to include new aspects of violence against women, such as stalking, to include same-sex couples in victim service protection, in a similar way to which the UN has expanded the concept of violence against women to embrace women all over the world. So when the UN says violence against women, we're not talking just necessarily about domestic violence, we're talking about human trafficking, we're talking about harmful cultural practices such as honor killings and female genital mutilation, we're talking about women as victims in armed conflict, and it's simply a much broader definition than perhaps criminal justice scholars are used to. It is also a definition and a concept that holds the state responsible. So whereas in criminal justice we normally consider offenders responsible for violence against women, and maybe prosecutors or police officers were not taking the issue seriously, the human rights framework clearly considers the state responsible and negligent if it is clear that violence against women is occurring and is very prevalent in any nation state. So it holds the state accountable for doing something about a social problem, something that in criminal justice we're not quite focused on. We're much more focused on trying to predict who might be a victim, what should be done to offenders, and perhaps how to enlighten police, prosecutors, and judges. What does the future hold then, I suppose, would be the next question. What are the challenges for this particular issue in international criminal justice or international human rights? I think, and we might hear it tonight at our session, the UN often concerns women and gender. So it often tends to assume that women are all going to be mothers, and so their maternal role must be protected, and many women will not become mothers, choose not to become mothers. It also assumes that women are naturally, instinctively good, peaceful people. So you have to have them at the peace table because they're nurturing, peaceful types, maybe because they're mothers. It also tends to assume that girls will want to be like their mothers, something that doesn't necessarily come to, hold true. And in many ways, it perpetuates stereotypes about women that in gender studies we very much question. In the UN system, it is only recently that any attention has been paid to LGBT issues, but these are still very much taboo in debates and discussions. And the UN is essentially a masculine institution, but it's very hard for the UN to take on gender, in other words, to push for the involvement of men and boys in the struggle for gender equality. Certainly the language is there, but there is very much a lack of action, and it's not UN gender. The agency is UN Women. So it is, although there are plenty of men that work at UN Women, there is always a bit of confusion about how exactly to get men on board, and what will their role be if we get them on board. The UN also has a tendency to assume that when we need more women in parliament and in government, you're about to cut me off, aren't you? That simply because women are elected and will be in parliament that they will push for women's rights, but that, as we know, is not always true. So there is quite, we call this essentialism in gender studies, there's quite a bit of essentialism. And I think it is that confusion that will mark future years, as well as the need for the UN and the World Bank to market women's issues as something that should attract funds and fundraising. The World Bank does this quite well by arguing that if there were gender equality, women's productivity would increase and hunger would decrease. The UN does it quite well through UN Women by arguing that if women are at the peace table or in countries where there is more gender equality, there is less likely to be terrorism and less likely to be armed conflict. There's more likely to be lasting peace. But many of these assumptions rest very and make women carry a very heavy burden as bearers of peace, bearers of equality, when equality is a responsibility of everyone. And I think I'll end it there before you cut me off, Aferdita. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Barberet. Next, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Ms. Barbara Borgese. Ms. Borgese is a second language English teacher and community coordinator at the Brooklyn International High School. Let's all welcome Ms. Borgese.
Good evening, everybody. You must excuse me, I'm a high school teacher, so I need to stand and move when I speak. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here tonight to talk to you about the work that we do at the Brooklyn International High School with immigrant and refugee youth, and in particular with our girls students. So just a little bit of background on our school. The Brooklyn International High School is a New York City public high school for recently arrived immigrant and refugee youth. All of our students are English language learners. In fact, in order to enroll in our school, students must have been in the United States for less than 4 years and not speak English as their native language. We are part of a network of international high schools throughout the city, the first of which was, let's see. I'll continue speaking while we get this fixed. So the first of these high schools was established in 1985, thanks to a collaboration between the New York City Department of Education and the City University of New York. And this was the LaGuardia International High School, which is currently based out of LaGuardia Community College. The model worked so well that in 1993 and 1994, respectively, two more international high schools were established, Manhattan International and the Brooklyn International High Schools. And so the need for the establishment of these schools really came out of research that had been conducted in the 1990s by the Department of Education regarding English language learners. And what this research found was that the number of English language learners that were enrolling in New York City public schools was increasing tremendously. During the 90s, there was an increase of 84% of students whose first English was not, whose first language was not English. And many of these students were enrolling in our public high schools. However, these were also the schools that were least equipped to deal with the needs of English language learners. Consequently, the need to establish schools who dealt with this specific population. And the model worked so well that these three international high schools decided to found a partnership. In 1995, the International Schools Partnership was developed in order to share in the best practices share the best curriculum in teaching English language learners. Interestingly enough, around the same period of time, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation initiated an education funding project to promote school improvement across the country. And they approached the International School Partnership to find out what was working for them. They observed the model and decided to replicate it. And it's thanks to funding from the Gates Foundation that in 2004, the International Network for Public Schools was established as a nonprofit whose mission was to support the existing international high schools and to replicate the model further. So this brings us to today, where we have 13 international high schools in New York City. They're all public high schools, and we have two in California with the hopes of continuing to expand. So as I mentioned before, the Brooklyn International High School was one of the first international high schools established in 94. Today, we enroll 360 English language learners in grades 9 through 12. A large portion of our students are refugees or asylees, 30% of them. And this is thanks to a partnership that we have developed with the International Rescue Committee. If you're not familiar with this organization, its mission is in large part to resettle refugees here in the United States. So many of our students come to us from countries in Southeast Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. Of course, this poses an additional challenge to the students and the teachers because it is now not just about teaching and learning English as a second language, but also dealing with other issues specific to this population. Many of these students have gaps in their formal education because of the fact that they come from countries that have been ravaged by conflict and war. And so many of them are defined as students with interrupted formal education, or SIFE, which is a term that was developed by the New York State Education Department and the New York City Department of Education in order to identify a subcategory of English language learners who not only don't speak English in their homes, but are at least 2 years behind their peers in reading, writing, and math. And so these are students who have gaps in their formal education. And there are 56% of the students enrolled at Brooklyn International are defined as SIFE based on DOE criteria. So just to give you a snapshot of our student demographics, so this is DOE data of our students' ethnicities based on students enrolled at Brooklyn International High School during this academic year, and the data is disaggregated by gender. So as I mentioned before, a large portion of our students come from Asian and in particular Southeast Asian countries, thanks to our partnership with the IRC. Overall, we enroll 52% of the students enrolled in our school are girls. And the next slide just shows the data on students with interrupted formal education. So again, the girls represent 51% of students that have gaps in their formal education. And I mentioned before conflict and war being one of the main factors that determines students' SIFE status. But of course, as you can imagine, it's not the only one, poverty being one of the other great determining factors. And many of our students, in fact, who are not refugees but are still SIFE students, come from countries where they were denied access to education, and mostly because of poverty. And so many of our girl students, or students in general, were former child laborers who, instead of spending time learning in school, have had to go to work and support their families in their home countries, or because they lived in rural areas where schools were not accessible, or simply because they were born a girl. And so in some countries, gender roles are so rigid that the role of girls and women, as was mentioned by the professor before, is in the household to take care of household chores, to take care of the family. Luckily, these girls then were resettled here in New York City and are now enrolled in our school, where we're supporting them in exercising their right to an education. And when I look at data on SIFE students and ELLs, I find that it paints a very sad, a very dim picture, and it doesn't really tell the full story of these students, because we look at all the challenges that these students have to face. But we rarely look at their resilience and the strengths that they bring with them. And so what I wanted to do is briefly highlight some of our student profiles. These are SIFE girls, students with interrupted formal education. I'll only focus on one of the profiles for time's sake. The names I have changed to protect the students' privacy, but the stories are true. And what I do want to highlight is the fact that all of our students bring with them a wealth of strengths and resources, their own funds of knowledge and their own intelligences that educators can and must tap into in order to help them succeed in high school, college, and beyond. And so this is the story of Marianne, who is a refugee from the Democratic Republic of the Congo. She arrived in the United States in 2005. Marianne has a tragic story because at age 13, she was snatched from her family and forcibly recruited into one of the armed groups fighting in the DRC. She worked and was used as a child soldier for 3 years, up until age 16, when she was saved by a local nonprofit organization. And the founder of this organization brought her here to the United States, is now her legal guardian. They have resettled in New York City. When Marianne arrived to the Brooklyn International High School in 2005, she was 16 years old and she was enrolling in the ninth grade. She graduated from BIHS in 2009, and she's currently attending Trinity College with a scholarship. She then decided that she wanted to use her personal experience for the benefit of others. And so together with a group of African students at her college, some of whom are also graduates from the Brooklyn International High School, she founded a small nonprofit whose mission is to fund education projects for young women in Africa. So this is a remarkable student who, when she came to the United States and enrolled at BIHS, spoke not a word of English. And this is what she's doing now. And I do believe that she, like many other of the students at her school, is a testament to the fact that with the right support systems in place, these students can overcome the worst obstacles, and they do overcome the worst obstacles, and they're enabled to become successful, not just as high school students, but in college and beyond. And just to prove that point, every year our high school graduates 85 to 90% of its students. Among this group, over 90% enrolls and attends college. And just to put these numbers into perspective, the New York City average for high school graduation is only 60% with the data from international high school students included in these numbers. And so our model, what has been working for our students? So there are many different aspects of our models that have been very effective with English language learners, and I just want to touch upon some of these. What we do every day is differentiate instruction for our students. And so differentiation is a term that was coined by Tomlinson. And it's based on the premise that every student learns in a different way. Every person is unique, and we all learn in very different ways. Some people may be more visual than others. Others may be more auditive. And so what differentiation does, in very simple terms, is allow students to access the same academic content in multiple ways. This does not mean that the content is watered down. To the contrary, the content remains academically rigorous, but it's different. It's the access into the information that is simplified. And so rather than providing students with the same textbook to read, some of our students may be provided with a reading in their native languages, or a student may choose that she wants to watch a video or listen to a recording of a specific reading in order to have access to that information. Similarly, multiple means of expressing what students have learned must be provided to them. And so rather than expecting all students to be at the same language level and write a 10-page essay, some students are also allowed the choice to prove their understanding through an oral defense of their work vis-a-vis their teacher or their classmates, or putting together a dramatization of a unit of study. In some language, must not be a barrier to the right to education. And I believe that the story of Marianne really proves that even though students come to us not speaking much English, that does not mean that they are less than any other students born in this country. Another important aspect of our work is participatory pedagogy. If you were to walk in an international classrooms today, what you would find is a group of students of different backgrounds, languages, ability levels, working together on similar or the same task. And so much of our work is student-centered and project-based, and this is because research has found that the best way to learn English is really to work collaboratively with others. But this also gives our students a sense of responsibility over their work and a sense of ownership over what they do. And so the teacher is merely a facilitator in our schools, and the students are empowered to share their ideas and learn how to communicate these with others. The last part of our model, the last aspect that I wanted to focus on, was building community partnerships. And this is especially important. It's important for all of our students. I wanted to focus on the benefit it has had for our girls' students. And I won't go into each point listed here because of time, but I did want to mention the first point on this slide, which is our partnership with the Sadie Nash, which is a nonprofit focused on helping to support girls build their literacy skills and develop and work on personal development, but also develop a sense of self, self-awareness and leadership skills. And the reason why I wanted to focus on this partnership is simply because it looks at different aspects of learning, educational supports and social emotional supports. And what we have learned in our international high schools over these past 25 years of working with English language learners is that academic learning hinges on social emotional well-being, and therefore these two aspects cannot be separated one from the other. Therefore, it is so vital for girls and for students to be given the necessary academic supports while also addressing their social and emotional needs, and providing them with the skill set necessary to be successful, not just in school as students, but in college and in life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Borgese. Our next speaker, it will be Mr. Conor French, who is the Chief Operating Officer and Chief Financial Officer for Indego Africa. Please join me in welcoming Mr. French.
First of all, I usually wouldn't want to preface anything, but I had the beginnings of allergy season kick up, so if I start desperately sneezing, please forgive me. I also am super honored to be, although it is, you know, a week past International Women's Day, it's an honor to be speaking in relationship to that day. My mother always reminds me that my due date originally was International Women's Day, and it being just before ultrasound, that she was hoping, as a women's rights activist, to have a daughter born on International Women's Day. And having lived with my own gender, she called me earlier this March and informed me that she thought it was actually cooler in some unlikely way that I'd become an outspoken enough proponent of women's rights as a son than if I'd ever been a daughter born on International Women's Day. So thank you. So Indego Africa is a 501c3 nonprofit social enterprise that connects for-profit cooperatives of artisan women in Rwanda to markets and education. Within that economic empowerment model, there's really two core elements. There's one in which we're partnering with these cooperatives on a fair trade basis in designing and developing products, mostly fashion accessories and home decor products. We're then marketing and selling them both on our e-commerce site as well as to major U.S. labels and brands. So we work with like J. Crew and Anthropology and Madewell and a couple of others. At the same time, so what the market access program really does is link these women to export markets to generate income for them to support themselves and their families. At the same time, we take 100% of any profit, so profit above the income being generated for the women, and pool that with donations to administer culturally tailored training programs for the same producer communities in financial management, entrepreneurship, literacy, and computers. Each of those training programs is actually taught by a Rwandan university student who's either a former orphan or a former socially vulnerable youth. A lot of times in Rwanda, orphan just means one parent has passed away. So that, I guess, is part of the youth hook of it. A lot of the women that we're working with are between the ages probably of 25 to 60, but then we also work with a subset of youth, Rwandan youth within our organization. The idea behind the training programs is that you're building sort of an educational pathway towards sustainable financial independence by giving them by diversifying their job skills and giving them an access, oftentimes retrofitting them with an education that I wish they'd gotten from Brooklyn, Brooklyn International School. So in terms of Indego Africa's approach to women's empowerment, we often say that it's driven by three things: by markets, education, and by partnerships. In terms of markets, what we're trying to do is to leverage an existing consumer goods market, and particularly consumer goods fashion. And in doing that, we're tapping into movements here, such as ethical consumerism or sustainable fashion. Rather than inventing an entirely new market, we are observing groups of artists and women who have a locally undervalued skill set and just linking them to a source of income during this period where they're obtaining skills so that their cooperatives can become self-sufficient and profitable. In terms of being market-driven, just as an organizational approach to small and medium enterprise development, we've kind of flipped it on its head. The way in the handicraft industry, which is a sort of well-traveled industry in certain regions of Africa, what people thought of as a social enterprise was really just going out, finding a bunch of cultural items that looked cool and coming back and sort of pawning them off on friends, family, and fools, as our country director likes to say. What we're trying to do is flip that equation over and really go out to the market here and identify what we see as a durable demand. And that's why we're working with some of these bigger name retail partners so that we can do higher volume orders that are sort of game changing, at least in the short term, for the women that we're working with. So rather than, you know, I guess maybe you need to know the culture, the landscape, the economic landscape a little better, but there's this epidemic almost of NGOs going into African countries and partnering with cooperatives of women, organizing them and coming back to their donors after 1 year and saying, you know, well, we organize an economic community, so, you know, everything is fine there, and leaving them, they probably brought one order, served as the entire market for that cooperative, and that cooperative is then scaled up, thinking that this is coming every year, and the NGO is gone and moved on to another cooperative. So we're looking at sort of longer term engagements, and so we don't want to start with the educational programming until we can tie it to market generating activity. So that's where we're kind of looking here at what consumer demand trends are. In terms of education, it's not a traditional market, but there is a willingness within philanthropy to invest in women's education. And so we're looking to tap into that or to link that women that we work with to that in terms of doing more traditional courses of fundraising, kind of with the pitch that you have your sort of buffet of options if you want to spend your philanthropic dollars on women's education in Africa. However, what you get as a sort of higher value investment from working with us is knowledge that we have a self-sustaining income generation project running simultaneously, so you can be assured that the woman whose education you're financing is able to take care of herself and her family. For our view, a lot of people get very hung up on this concept of trade, not aid. And while I think that there are certain merits to that, I think that without education or training, all you end up with is a system of reliance where people are, it's heavily, we call it Mzungu facilitated, or foreigner facilitated, sort of in perpetuity. So we need to have both these components going side by side in order to provide all of the necessary skill set going forward that gives these women an opportunity to move towards, you know, long-term financial independence. And that's why we look at each of these engagements as longer-term longer-term interactions. We actually like to say that our goal is to put ourselves out of business with respect to any one partner cooperative. In terms of partnerships, both businesses and traditional aid suffer when people drift outside of their core competencies. As a young social enterprise, your core staff, you're underpaid, people are making personal sacrifices. We're trying to really run what amounts to sometimes three businesses at once, retail and wholesale, which are very, very different, as well as running a business school. So it's important to like look at the range of partners that are out there, and I know that you've been talking about implementation partners with respect to the UN. So we look at having long-term retail partners like, you know, the fashion design, I don't know how fashionable the room is, I was not very involved in it, but the fashion designer Nicole Miller, for instance, has now been working with us for 2 years and has been to work with the cooperative. She's been to Rwanda to teach them sort of advanced techniques that she thinks will be important for upcoming lines. So to create those type of long-term partnerships between particular cooperatives and a larger marketplace here. We also use, in terms of our educational programming, partnerships because education is just, training is just expensive to implement. And so you need a clear set of desired outcomes and you can't train everybody sort of forever. And so the way that we've gone about doing it in a sort of cost-effective manner is partnering with another NGO called Generation Rwanda, which provides highly competitive scholarships to orphans and socially vulnerable youth. And so they're desperately in need of professional development opportunities for their scholarship students. And we're looking for this pipeline of heavily vetted young Rwandan trainers. That relationship's been even cooler because over the couple of years, we've had very high-performing interns then be hired as full-time staff. And from my experiences of working in Africa, there's nothing more satisfying than using your own organization as a tool for the empowerment of local kids in the community. We also work with certain academic partners. I would hope to add John Jay to that. We work very closely with NYU Law. I'm an alumni. I'm a former corporate lawyer. We work with Harvard Business School quite a bit, and then Columbia Law School. Those are very important relationships, and we're always looking to broaden that because of what she was saying about changing the conversation. We like to say it as sort of disrupting the conversation about everything to do with how NGOs do business, to how women's empowerment is done. That's why we preach business infrastructure, transparency, accountability. And it's our belief that, on the one hand, things like transparency and assessing impact, it's the right thing to do. So there's a moral purpose there. But there's a parallel business purpose that I think that we're going to see stakeholders. Expectations change. They're no longer going to get gratified the minute they write the check and give it to a charity. They're going to want their charitable portfolio to outperform another theoretical charitable portfolio. So to be able to communicate in a language that that makes people feel comfortable that they're getting the most for their contributions, I think is going to be very important down the line. We also work with other NGOs to broaden because someone from high school must know, like, there's any number of wraparound services you can provide, particularly in developing countries. So rather than trying to do it all ourselves, we've been working with people to provide breast cancer awareness training, domestic violence training, which is particularly important when you start to have meteoric rise in a woman's income. It can very much disrupt the dynamics of a household. So we've been working with a lot of NGOs in order to diversify the training offerings we're able to provide. I wanted to, I guess, situate some of what we're doing within the broader dialogue, particularly because of some of the more general platforms that have been brought up with respect to the UN. The way I look at it, sort of in its simplest form, is has anyone read Half the Sky? Okay. Well, the central, a lot of the dialogue had been going on, but it sort of reinforced these concepts. I mean, in their terms, that gender inequity was kind of the slavery of our time. Whether that's true, but the idea that there's this moral or cultural imperative to remedy gender equity around the globe, and that should be sort of the primary moral or cultural imperative of our time. The second point that they started to move into, and which a lot of studies have really reinforced, is the multiplier effect and the effectiveness with which investing in women is investing in the community around them. You'll hear the statistic a lot that a woman, when you invest in a woman, 90% of it she puts right back into her own family, and the rest goes towards things like education. Men tend to have this like bucket of like tobacco, alcohol, prostitutes. Like there's, it's not the whole thing, but there's 25% or so that's going in that direction. So here we have the sort of, we're doing it because it's the right thing to do. then we're doing it because it's the effective thing to do. And part of where I'm trying to enter the thought leadership argument is I'm going to try to say it's the smart thing to do. That there are compelling business reasons to be integrating women-owned businesses into supply chains. You look at things like food, for us, fashion accessories or home decor products. Who is buying those? It's women. So there's a compelling reason to connect a woman consumer here with a story of women, a vertical supply chain that has all women-owned producer communities. That's a compelling business reason for us. Or if you look at other bigger industries like food products and you project out what the consumer base will look like in 15, 20 years, you start to see that the women are going to command a lot of capital and be a lot of purchasing power. You're also going to, if you're going to win in the race for human capital within your own company, you need to be investing in training women so that they can join and become part of your workforce. And so I think that it's not that we believe in that above the other ones, it's just kind of like going out there with a full range of arguments to attract as many different people to understand just how much investing in women can mean, and to not limit it when you sort of have run out of your sort of first, your preference argument. So that's kind of the way that I look at it. A last piece of that, she already alluded to it. I'm actually a Truman National Security Fellow, so that's an unlikely sort of thing to be in what I'm doing. But the idea there is that they see a tremendous national security function and cost-effective national security function in international development and economic development in the sort of artisan communities, in Africa. So just bringing a lot of that stuff together.
Our next and final speaker for tonight is Ms. Qaterannada Rehan. I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong. Ms. Rehan is a former youth participant in the Seeds of Peace initiative. Let's welcome Ms. Rehan.
Hello, I hope you all are having a great day. My name is Qaterannada Rehan. I'm Palestinian. I'm 17 years old. I was born on April 17th, 1994 in Ramallah, Palestine. I was born in the year when the Palestinian government came back to Palestine. I was born on the Prisoners' Day, when all Palestinians stand up for the rights of the Palestinian prisoners in the Israeli jails, and those people who devoted their lives to give us a better future. The day when I was born is the day when people fight for dignity, justice, humanity, and the hope for a better tomorrow. My mother gave birth to me at 5:30 a.m. I was born with a sunrise. I know that I was born to leave this earth just a bit better than I last found it. My family lives in Amari refugee camp near Ramallah. It has a population of 10,000 people. They all live on 90 acres. Growing up, all I saw for the most time were all those ugly, crowded houses in Amari. I saw a very dirty place where you would never think that people could actually survive there. I thought the whole world looked the same way for the longest time. I thought the whole world was just a big refugee camp where everybody suffers. I would hear bumps through the night and hold on my parents, thinking that there might not be tomorrow. Thinking that maybe this is the last time I will get to hold my parents. I remember how my siblings and I were used to hide in the closet when the smell of the gas tear bombs would be everywhere. The first time I remember the Israeli soldiers coming to my house, I was about 7. They came to my house at 3 a.m. They broke down the house. They destroyed everything. They even threw the food we had stored out. I remember them hitting my dad. And I remember learning what it meant to feel helpless. I couldn't help my own dad. I couldn't stop them. There was nothing I could do. These things happen every day in the refugee camp. The soldiers were at my family's house last night, actually. To be honest, what I remember out of my childhood is not that much. But it's those moments of fear that last with you forever. In 2007, I got a scholarship to go to Lebanon for an international summer camp. That was the first time I left Palestine. And that was the first time when I realized that the rest of the world doesn't live like us. The rest of the world is free.
And for the first time, I got to be free with them. I could walk everywhere. I could go to any city I wanted to go to. I could sleep and be sure that nobody was going to bump me. It was also the first time that I went to the sea. It made me realize how simple our dreams are. The kids in my refugee camp would dream of going to the sea, would dream of having a nice place to play. You know, maybe some real dolls would help too. We dream of being able to sleep one night without fear. We don't dream of having a big house. We don't dream of a fancy car. We don't dream of a trip around the world. Going to Lebanon, I discovered that life is bigger than a Amari refugee camp. But the kids there could only see that word. They still just play with the rocks instead of the bowls. They still believe that suffering is normal when it's not normal. It's not okay. When I came back to Amari, I know that there's so much I wanted to change. I know that we deserve to live like the rest of the kids in the world. I know we're humans. We have rights. I know I couldn't feed all of them. I knew I couldn't help all of them, which is why I started volunteering for local organizations in Ramallah. I'm a volunteer for about 15 organizations in my city. I realized that not all giving is something you can touch. So many times, giving is something you can feel. I decided that those small things that could change the course of a single day, that was all I could give. But I always wanted to give more. I always wanted to be able to help more people. In 2009, I was chosen to go to the Seeds of Peace summer camp in Maine. It was the first time for me to come to the United States. And it was the first opportunity for me, other kids from my age, from Israel, Jordan, India, Pakistan, and Egypt. It was the first time I was really able to talk to an Israeli kid on my age. An Israeli person who was not trying to kill me on a checkpoint. An Israeli person who wasn't coming into my refugee camp to arrest my dad. I could see them as a human being. Seeds of Peace was an exceptional moment in my life. It was an opportunity for me to learn how to really listen. Initially, I thought most of the other seeds did not know what it was like for us in the refugee camps. I thought if they know, they wouldn't believe that it could be right that people would live in those conditions or in that much fear. Throughout the summer, we told our stories. Initially, I found it really hard to listen to Israelis' stories. One girl who was an Israeli seed in Seeds of Peace, she lived close to Gaza, and one time, a rocket was thrown and it broke her window 7 years before, and she couldn't sleep for 7 years in her room because of the fear she felt. And I remember at the moment, I was like, how silly, like really? And then now, if there's something that I took at a Seeds of Peace, then it's having the ability to listen and to put myself in other people's shoes. In my refugee camp, a broken window is just something you can fix. And you're just happy that it's not anything worse. You're happy everybody in the house is alive. You fix the window, you go back to your room, and you sleep again. While I was there, I was told the story about how I never knew my grandpa because he was killed by 3 Israeli soldiers. He was leaving the mosque. He was shot in the head 3 times. He didn't die right away. He was surrounded by 3 Israeli soldiers, and they watched him take his last breath. They watched him die. They didn't let the ambulance get to him. He was 56 when he died, and he died during the first intifada. And even after he died, they wanted the body, and my dad had to steal the body and bury it. My uncle was shot within the next few minutes as well. My father, when I told this story at the Seeds of Peace, I was crying. I was really emotionate about it. And one of the other seeds, he's a Druze Israeli boy, he stopped me and he was like, you know, your grandpa was killed for a reason. He was killed because he's a terrorist. And if you stay the same way, we will kill you too. While I was at the camp, I did learn how to listen to what Israelis were saying better. But I didn't come away feeling like they learned how to listen to me better. Or that they learned to see that humanity exists in all Palestinians. I know that spending the summer at Sita Feast made me a person who's able to listen before a judge. But I felt something lacking from some of my fellow seeds. The same boy who told me my grandpa was killed because he was a terrorist told me at the end of the summer that if he came to raid my house, that he wouldn't hurt me because he knew me. Another Israeli boy, who I considered to be my friend that summer, said at the end of the summer that all Palestinians are terrorists. One of the counselors asked him then about me because she knew we were friends. And he said that I was an exception because he knew me. What first strikes me is that I can see the Israelis that I met in Sita Feast in every Israeli that I meet. But they can't see me in the Palestinians they meet. When they go to join the army, they say that they won't hurt me if I am the person on the other side of their gun. But why can't they think twice if it's another Palestinian? Sita Feast was a great moment in my life, but it was only a moment. It was difficult. It is so difficult to stand here and criticize such good intentions and good work by an organization. But in this case, I think it's very important. When I left the bubble that I was living in that summer, I realized that what we spent the summer doing did not really mean that much in the larger picture. I still went back to the Amari refugee camp, and my Israeli friends still went to the army. Sita Feast also made the division between us more obvious. A few months after we came back, I saw one of the Israeli seeds when I was passing through a checkpoint. He was guarding the checkpoint from Palestinians. I realized that in that moment, that this boy that had been my friend was unreachable. If I moved to say hi to him, I would be shot because of the other Israeli soldiers would think that I'm a threat. If I told my Palestinian friends that I knew an Israeli soldiers, everybody would think I'm a spy. My only option was to just keep walking and act like it never happened. All I could think afterwards was, what did I spend my summer at Sita Feast doing? Did it really change anything? After Sita Feast, however, I was more motivated to pursue things that would improve the life of those in my community and make sure that I got an education so that I could do things to help Palestinians. The Sita Feast experience made me view myself as someone who can make a difference, not just for Palestinians, but for everybody. In 2010, I was selected to spend a semester in Alabama with a host family through the YES program. In 2001, I got accepted to Mount Holyoke College with almost a full scholarship because my family had no way to afford my education, and I'm very thankful for Mount Holyoke. My mom said I had to pay a loan for college, and my mom was like, so what am I supposed to tell a possible husband for my daughter that she has $20,000 debt for college? So Amadeus paid my loan for college, and now I'm on a full scholarship. My inner drive comes from knowing that so many Palestinians have never known anything besides the refugee camps, and that maybe, just maybe, I can make things a bit better. I made things a lot better for me at Sita Feast, which means that maybe if I keep pushing, I can create a ripple effect that will make the change bigger. Sita Feast was a beautiful moment in my life, one that can never be recreated. But I will continue looking for more of those moments like it so I can bring a positive change. I know that I was born to make the world a better place, and I believe that each one of us was made to make this world a better place. I'm not here to tell you to cry because I had a bad story. I'm here to ask you to take the story with you. And I'm here to say that I want to make a difference, but I can't make the difference alone. The difference is made by all of us. And I'm here because I believe in humanity. I believe in each one of you, and I believe that we can make it a better world. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Ms. Rehan, and thank you to all the speakers. At this time, we'd like to open the floor for discussions We welcome comments and questions.
I'd like to congratulate everybody to put this thing up. It's very, very exciting. My name is Ali Sadra. I'm coming from across the river from New Jersey. I'm Iranian originally, a human rights and political activist. I have a comment and question, if I may ask Mr. French about any experience about microfinancing, if you can comment on that, if there is any part of your work includes that or not. I have to leave the room. I apologize if you did mention that and I missed it. You didn't?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
The comment I was going to make, I really would love to congratulate my 17-year-old sister that reminds me of all the sisters that I have in Iran, most of them the same age, a ball of fire, and that's what they are. You hear Islamic Republic of Iran being in the power for the last 30 years, and the main pressure, main suppression is on women. I can tell you a lot worse stories about the Iranian people. Not for you to cry, not for you to be upset, just for you to learn that as long as we have half of the 75 million people in Iran being treated the way they are, we're not going to see any peace in the world, because Iran, as the center, as the heart of the Islamic 1.5 billion people, Islamic world, needs to change, needs to have a democratic government before we are seeing some peace in the region, including Palestine. As probably you know, they finance all kinds of violence activities and everything else. You have sad stories to say, but girls around your age, if they are in the prison before they get shot, before they are executed, they are raped, because a virgin should not be executed. They go to heaven. So according to the law, they have to be virgin. They cannot be virgin. They rape them. And the next day, they go to their parents, and they introduce them as their son-in-law. They give the belongings of that girl to the parents of the person who was killed. What I would like to ask, especially Ms. Borgese, I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your name. I would love to hear your experience with Iranian girls in your high school. What I can tell you is, unfortunately, things that you see in that age, high school age, and even in the college age, the girls from Iran may not come forward as much as they really should. And again, touching upon the importance of that region in the, without exaggeration, the peace in the entire world, I would love to hear that if there is any emphasis on engaging Iranian girls. And again, thank you very much and congratulations for your program.
I can just address the microfinance question very quickly. In terms of what we do, we do not do microfinance. The only thing that's sort of close is we pay all of the wages to the women, 50% upon placing an order, and then the second 50% upon delivery in Rwanda. So we're absorbing 100% of the commercial risk, and so either the wages or the raw materials could be something tantamount to microfinance. But that's sort of beside the point. The way I see us interacting with microfinance is we teach microfinance preparedness as part of our business planning and entrepreneurship curriculum, and the hope is that we would help enable the women we work with to have access to probably not microloans and what people are thinking of just the kind of very, very small individual. But if you pay attention to the current state of the microfinance debate, they're always talking about the missing middle and the sort of small and medium enterprises and the lack of women-owned small and medium enterprises in which to lend to, even if it's a women-focused SME lending group. And so we're trying to develop capacity among women-owned businesses in order to be potential recipients if they wanted to invest in their business to buy, you know, a retail shop or something like that. So we could foreseeably interact with it, but, you know, are not ourselves a microfinance bank.
Thank you, Mr. French. Was there a question? Oh, yes.
So in terms of our Iranian students, I can't speak specifically about Iranian girls, but we do have a large student population from Arabic countries. And so what we have tried to do at our high school is really to promote communication among all the different cultures represented. We have students coming from over 50 different countries. And some of the issues that students may encounter, especially in the first years that they're with us when they can't communicate very well in English, is a lot of cultural misunderstanding. And so to avoid these types of issues, we've developed culture clubs where students from different cultures join together once a week, and it's a time for them, a safe space for them to really celebrate their culture and speak their native languages. We have an Arabic club an Arabic girls club and an Arabic boys club, which meets weekly at our school. And part of what these clubs do is also educate other students on their own cultures and try to promote their culture throughout the school through various different events. And it's a time for students to really learn how to communicate with each other, with students whose backgrounds and cultures are so different from one another. One of the things that we work very hard to do at our school is really to promote cross-cultural understanding so that our students can learn to be productive in today's multicultural society. And so this is what our culture clubs have been doing. The Arabic club has been in existence for over 10 years at our school, and it's a very active club. And it's very much engaged school-wide.
No Iranians.
Sorry?
No Iranians, though.
Not that I'm aware of, no.
My name is Saida, and I'm actually a CUNY BA student majoring in International Human Rights and Oriental Studies. I have a question for Professor Barberet and Ms. Rehan. Do you feel that the continual violence against women raises from the very essentialist rhetoric that distinguishes binaries between men and women in the first place? And considering the U.S. is less ignorant towards women equalities than most countries, will women ever receive an equal pay to men, or will the ratio remain 77% to every dollar a man makes within our prevalent society? And for being a Palestinian woman, a part of 15 nonprofit organizations, and facing the traumatizing events that you face, what contributions do you want to make in the international community in the future? Well, international human rights community.
Professor, would you like to go first?
That was a tough question. I don't know if I have the answer to that question. When I was in college, I think it was how many cents to the dollar? It was much worse. It was in the 60s when I do remember those buttons in the 80s. So it's encouraging. In many ways, it's highlighted in the World Bank Gender Equality Report that important strides have been made. And I think that people who work for gender equality are getting smarter. So they're learning other arguments besides the fact that people should just sort of naturally support gender equality gains and that everybody should support women's rights. I think they're looking for other justifications. I think the marketing is getting more sophisticated. I'm not sure that the marketing is necessarily evidence-based. I actually don't know if I've seen any study on the relationship of artisan communities to the terror crime nexus. I think many of those arguments, smart power, I'm not sure I've ever seen any research that equates gender equality with national and international security issues. Where there is obviously more research has to do with development, gender equality and development, but there are some very important assumptions behind that. Certainly, there are many people who study gender equality who criticized the World Bank for always wanting women to be productive. And I think that's something that my question to you might be, who's watching the children? And why doesn't anybody ever ask the men why they have this bucket for prostitutes and alcohol and tobacco? And that's sort of my contribution to disrupting the conversation. When are men going to be held accountable in some way? And do women have to do it all? Do they have to watch the hearth? Do they have to go out to work? Do they have to take care of their aging relatives? Do they have to pursue education and training? This is the sort of mindset that my generation grew up with, and it's actually created a generation of very stressed out, unhappy women. So this expectation that women are sort of going to bear all of these things so that the world becomes a better place is leaving out other people who could be doing their part. And I guess that would be my answer to your question.
I mean, just to add, I feel like it's from the sound of it, you would prefer to dedicate your life to working with men on those issues. Like, I don't know, like, you can only, if you're, I work exclusively with business partners that are women, so the focus is on them sort of blazing a trail towards you know, financial independence. Someone else can go work with their husbands on it. I just, you know, we're looking at the bandwidth of what we can do.
To answer your question, when I started doing volunteer work, I felt like it was the most they can do. And I felt like, I realized that it's not about doing great things, it's about doing the small things in a great way. I believe that change is huge, and if you can make even if a small difference, we can all make this world a better place. Answering your question, I think that knowledge is power. And that the first step to make life better in Palestine is by making people aware of what's happening in Palestine and where Palestine is. As a Palestinian, when I say I'm from Palestine, the answer that I get most of the time is like, oh, Pakistan? No, it's in a different region, y'all, you know? So I think that the first step is to spread knowledge, because I believe in humanity, and I believe that you can always relate to someone's story, because we're all humans. And I think that if we all know about what's happening, I don't think the world is going to be satisfied by all of the crimes that are happening against Palestinians.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions or comments?
Yes,
please stand up. I see, okay, Sally, one, and then I see one in the back. That's two, and then third is there. Okay.
Hi, my name is Suhaili Abdul-Ghaffar, and I'm a student here at John Jay, and I'm also a CUNY BA student. My major is International Human Rights and Gender Studies, so women's rights is a huge topic for me, and my question is primarily to Mr. Cohen. I'm working with a nonprofit that I started with my co-founder, and it's primarily located in the Middle East and in North Africa, and a lot of things we do are social empowerment workshops. And we worked with an organization called NIMNY Foundation, which was doing something similar to what you were doing, having women make necklaces, finding ways for them to generate income. And the question was asked, should we maybe work with American corporations, H&M, Forever 21, should we reach out to them? And we ended up having a fear that the issue would be that we'd be generating income for American-based markets, rather than creating income for the local communities. And so one thing we did find was that would probably be a great effort to do is creating maybe a food justice network, having women make food, having them, even if it's strawberries or apples, or creating their own food source. That way the poverty issue isn't an issue anymore, and at least they can feed themselves even if they don't have the money. So have you thought of ways maybe to create community-based stability in creating local community markets?
Right. I mean, I certainly wouldn't object to people teaching nutrition and having women build their own gardens. And again, to the point where I think you do have to look at what are your own core competencies as an organization. So when we've done that, we've tried to partner with existing NGOs that are working on sustainable food solutions. In terms of the calculus of export market access, I mean, I, actually couldn't really disagree more. The sales are being made in the U.S., so you're not making money for a U.S. corporation. You're just changing the already existing supply chain of where they're sourcing from. So it's not like if I was setting up, you know, a retail face completely, yes, we could be making money if we were a for-profit, you know, but we're not. It is important, though, to me, which is a different model than I think has traditionally been peddled, that each party along the supply chain does turn a profit. So people get a little bit upset when, you know, Nicole Miller or J. Crew will take credit for something that seems socially responsible, but they are actually making a profit. Those relationships, and I, for anyone who is interested, I just co-wrote with Nicole Miller an article in McKinsey's Quarterly about our design relationship. And the idea is that you want, there's a lot more sustainability to the partnerships if you're aligning both business interests as well as core social objectives, so that, you know, something as simple as turning a profit is something that's always going to have to happen for the producer community, which is a for-profit of Rwandan women, and the for-profit U.S. retail brand, where the tension between social and enterprise really comes into play most is with us in the middle, because every single order is good for the women we work with. Our bottom line can get a little bit scary if we were to take a loss on products or things like that ourselves as a nonprofit. But I think that you will see ways in other industries. You know, ours just happens to be the consumer goods arena. But you will see, you know, for instance, I don't want to vouch for particular corporations out there, but the types of products, type of initiatives I see being launched. For instance, I just spoke with the architect of Walmart's new Women 360, and they're looking at trying to change this. And that's Walmart, if most people know, is a food products store in a lot of different geographies. And so theoretically, a lot of the women's supply chains they'll be using will be based around food and things like that. Again, I think that even with those bigger initiatives, you're going to find a difficulty identifying small and medium enterprises that are women-owned. I just don't think there are that many in certain regions. And so hopefully that's where our capacity-building efforts can have a more sustainable effect by plugging women into it.
Thank you, Mr. French. Just we have two more questions or comments, but let's try to keep it briefly because we're running out of time.
Okay, I have a comment and I think two questions, but maybe I'll just ask one. My name is Lama Hassoun. I'm an adjunct here in the anthropology department at John Jay, and I'm a researcher at the Center for Core Innovation, and I've done a lot of work on women and girls. I got my graduate degree from the Harvard School of Public Health, and most of my work focused on refugee women and violence against women. So these are issues that are really important to me, and happy International Women's Day. And my comment is really kind of a criticism, but not necessarily of Mr. French's organization, but maybe putting some of these things into context. I mean, I think there are a lot of organizations, as you said, there's an epidemic of NGOs that are going into Africa that are doing these kinds of things. And there's two things, I think. The first one is economic development as a goal in and of itself is insufficient. You know, increasing the income of people or even giving them education hasn't necessarily led to the health outcomes, maternal mortality outcomes, other outcomes that we're looking for when we try to meet MDGs or other goals. And in fact, there's a growing movement in the international development arena that's looking more towards examining people's abilities and capabilities and how do we remove barriers to them achieving their existing goals. I mean, we're flooding Africa and other continents with all these things that aren't necessarily improving the actual standard of life of people, although we might be increasing their income slightly. And that is connected to how women are experiencing domestic violence as a result of some of these economic development programs, right? Like, NGOs have to start asking themselves the question, is it worth putting a woman's life at risk to increase her income if we're not changing the way the culture looks at women and examining why violence is occurring to women? I mean, I guess it's a bigger problem, but I think NGOs need to be part of this advocacy.
Right. I mean, I would say yes. I'm not going to back down from empowering women because there's a threat of sometimes upsetting family dynamics. I think that that's a huge, would be a mistake. Within the context that I work in, it is unique, and we've run sensitivity analyses there. Rwanda in 1994, after the genocide, was 70% women. So more, perhaps even by necessity, we're looking at the only country in the world that has a majority of women in parliament. It's about 55%. There's threshold rules. I think it can't go below 30%. So it is a cultural context and a social context that is at least understanding the important role that its population of women plays in the country's future. That occasionally we do see domestic violence or you know, different incidents crop up is certainly cause for concern and certainly something where we have to be very thoughtful about making sure that these women are prepared to deal with that. But saying that, you know, you don't have the right to touch money like is going on in Burundi, stuff like that, just because it might shake things up a little bit, is just not for me an option.
Right, but we say that now until like women start dying, like they do.
Women are already dying. There's millions of women disappearing.
No, I'm not arguing against that, but I'm just saying like it needs to be a much more holistic approach. Like all we talk about is income and education, and we forget about all these other cultural things that need to be addressed at the same time. That's the first thing that I want to say. But one other thing, there's also a larger context, I think, especially when it comes to economic development, which is a lot of the reasons these economies are depressed or women can't sell their products locally is because of U.S. policies or IMF policies or World Bank policies that are backed by the U.S. And I mean, I think that's another area where everyone in this room can take a position by lobbying here in the United States to change some of these policies that are deleterious to the economies of countries all around the world. We flood Haiti with rice, and Haitian farmers can't sell their rice because U.S. rice is cheaper. We do the same thing with T-shirts and clothing in Africa, and then African clothing becomes, you know, priceless.
I mean, with that, I completely, like, people who adore the one-for-one model that, you know, that is Tom's Shoes and a lot of other very, very celebrated social enterprises, I think that they're terrific at, if you understand what they're trying to do, which is market to you as a consumer, and they're not gonna, that's not a holistic solution to global poverty, but that's exactly why I'm not in the one-for-one model of business. I don't, as long as it works as a marketing technique here, you know, that's good for the companies that are using it, but that's not necessary. I mean, I don't know. Sorry, I've just seen you go from different instance of failed approach to different instance of failed approach, and I'm not really sure. I mean, sure, yes, if I felt very strongly that the UN was protecting all of the women's rights across the globe and it was a holistic solution, that is perhaps the future. That is perhaps where we should be going. But right now, I see us very, very, very far away from that. I mean, we apparently just condensed four bureaus into one, and that was a major step of progress, but still it shows how far, how disparate those efforts already were at the time.
Right, but it's
I think we should try to continue that maybe later on in the
session. Can you just, one question. Do you have any formal evaluation of your program?
Yeah, totally. I mentioned we believe in social impact assessments. Not many people in our space do it. It's not, you know, it's not the most comprehensive always. We're actually on our fourth in 5 years. We're finishing up and we'll release it in May. So definitely look at it. The last one's about a year old now. We assess a number of quantitative metrics, like, you know, obviously more income, access to bank accounts, access to water, you know, food security, sending children to school, things like that. We also do assess qualitative indicators like quality of life, self-perception, confidence, because, again, you know, one of the hardest things is confidence is a very hard thing to measure, and it can be game-changing for people. So, yeah, we certainly are using social impact assessments, both because we're trying to demonstrate an impact-based return, but we're also see that as crucial if you're going to identify areas for future growth and improvement for your organization and operations.
Okay, I think we have time for one more comment or question, and we'll be wrapping up really soon. Someone else that hasn't been heard? Yes, please.
Good evening.
Please introduce yourself.
Yes, my name is John Yuski. I'm a public administration major here at John Jay College. I'm very interested in Mr. French's project. As a matter of fact, I approve it. I think it's a good thing because I grew up in the United States, American born, and I remember when I used to watch TV 30 years ago, there's all these charities just saying, throw money at Biafra, throw money here. I believe that just giving aid without giving people the knowledge and skills they need to sustain themselves is not a good thing. And I believe that this model where you teach people how to run and operate a business, it also raises their self-esteem because they do things with their hands, they see it's appreciated, and they feel appreciated, and their self-esteem rises. But I remember when I was doing a research paper for my MBA in international business at Baruch, I was studying something called the Ishupal in India, where it enabled farmers to communicate, to do price discovery, to get better price for their crops. But I remember coming across a similar project that was in Africa, I think I read about in The Economist, where the women got something going, and it was producing revenue, but it was a tribal society, and when the men saw that these women were making the money, they just went in and took it over. And eventually, it just shut down. Are you doing anything to protect these people, to keep it going, or to care for
them? I mean, yeah, I mentioned that we'd work with the, I think it's, could get it wrong, but I think the International Justice Mission is who came in and conducted domestic violence trainings. Unfortunately, Rwanda is a society, you know, again, the specific context we're working in, a society where many, many, many of the women we work with are widows. So that in a sad, you know, for instance, one of the cooperatives that we work with is about 2/3 of them are genocide survivors. So we actually work with all inter-ethnic cooperatives, just using economic community to help promote unity and reconciliation post-genocide. But then the other third is are women whose husbands were killers and so are currently in prison. And so the idea is that they would they sort of suffered the same fate in some ways in terms of having becoming forced widows. But you know, again, that just shows you that entire cooperatives of women are that we're working with are widows. And again, I totally understand how alarming and concerning it could be that, particularly when instances of domestic violence are so difficult to face in the communities where you're working. But I would also argue that domestic violence is pretty rampant here, where socioeconomic things aren't being addressed in the same way, or there's not the change in those dynamics. So I don't know exactly how much of it's directly attributable to it. It's not a trend we've seen, that's been terribly significant, and we've tried to do kind of what we could responsibly do about it. You know, we keep part of the model is to ensure that these women are in their own for-profit cooperatives and their own businesses, and so stepping into some their business decisions is something we would treat very carefully. Like, you know, we would not usurp their sort of internal business functions. Stepping into their own domestic lives, I think, would probably have disastrous effects. But you know, people are welcome to disagree.
I think we have to end actually the formal discussions. But you're welcome to address your questions and comments informally over the mini reception that we have in the back. At this time, I would like to thank all the panelists here today. I would also like to let everyone know that the video of this event will be up on our website. So if you'd like to see it online, just please add your name to our list server, and we'd be happy to send it over. And that's all. Thank you very much for all being here today.